Welcome to the Epic Flight Academy's Commercial Pilot Course. Today, we will discuss the Lazy Eight. The keys to success for this maneuver are, number one, complete your A squared, B squared, C squared checklist. Number two, planning. The maneuver must be symmetrical at the 45, 90, and 135 degree points with altitude and airspeed the same at each 180 degree point in all four loops. Four loops? Hang on. Number three, airspeed and bank angle targets must be met. Number four, smooth and positive control inputs with constant small inputs and corrections. Number five, maintain coordination throughout the maneuver. Number six, do not stall at any point in the maneuver. And number seven, perform the maneuver visually. This is not an instrument maneuver. References for this maneuver will not be the way that I do it, or the way my instructor showed me, or any specific flight school's method, but rather the Airplane Flying Handbook 8083-3 Charlie. By the way, the EPIC Standardization Manual follows the Airplane Flying Handbook 8083-3 Charlie. Please open the Airplane Flying Handbook to Chapter 10, Page 6, and follow along as I walk you through the maneuver. While this maneuver is commonly referred to as a performance maneuver, it is more accurately thought of as a coordination maneuver. Page 10-6 in the Airplane Flying Handbook tells us that the maneuver is designed to develop the proper coordination of the flight controls across a wide range of airspeeds and attitudes. And it is the only standard flight training maneuver in which control pressures are constantly changing. Now, this maneuver is called a Lazy Eight. And we often wonder, why? An instructor might explain, well, it's a figure eight laying on its side. But what exactly does that mean? Well, first of all, the maneuver is traditionally performed making four loops. In the diagram, figure 10-4 on page 10-6, only the first two loops are shown. The first loop to the right and the second loop to the left. This diagram is one half of the maneuver. Secondly, think of the longitudinal axis of the airplane as a pencil coming out of the propeller spinner. See the paragraph at the bottom of page 10-6. As we fly the complete four-loop maneuver, here is what it will look like. Here is the horizon. The first part of the maneuver is a climbing and descending turn or loop to the right. This is followed by a climbing and descending loop to the left. Here we are halfway through the maneuver. Now, begin a climbing and descending turn or loop to the left, and this is followed by a loop to the right, and that is your figure eight lazily laying on its side. So you see, the full maneuver has four loops. To properly fly the maneuver, pick three clear ground references as far off in the distance as you can. Here is a diagram from an earlier version of the Airplane Flying Handbook where the three distant points can be seen more clearly. We've labeled them here for clarification. In this diagram, we enter to the right, and after we fly both loops, we are halfway done. We will then enter to the left and fly the remaining two loops. Notice, and this is important, as we reverse the loops on the 8, we simply relabel and swap our 45 and 135 degree points, but we keep the same three points. Upon completion of all four loops, we'll have our 8 laying on its side, our lazy 8. Now, let's look at the first single loop in this maneuver in figure 10-4 and break it into four parts. Part number one, A to B. Number two, B to C. Number three, C to D. And part four, D to E. Begin by setting up in straight and level flight with gear and flaps up and a distant ground reference object off your right wingtip at 90 degrees at the recommended airspeed. The Cessna POH recommends entering the maneuver at VA of 105. But because we're going to be below gross weight in the practice area, the EPIC standardization manual recommends an entry airspeed of 100 knots. Also, while this is a ground reference maneuver and not a ground track maneuver, we're not so concerned about wind direction and its effect on our ground track. However, you'll want to enter with the wind at your altitude at 90 degrees to your airplane, as we show here. This way, you'll be blown along a straight line to your distant 90 degree ground reference. If you enter with a tailwind or a headwind, you'll be blown upwind or downwind of your straight line to your distant 90 degree ground reference, making it harder to make your loops symmetrical. Remember, this is part of your A squared, B squared, C squared checklist. Now, at point A, the right wingtip is on the distant 90 degree point, and we have a crosswind. From the left or right, doesn't matter. From A to B, we are pitching up and rolling. However, remember that we are pitching to maximum at point B, but rolling to only half of our bank angle. So there will be more pitch than bank at this point in the maneuver. As we pitch up, we will feel the effect of P factor and we will lose airspeed. So our turn in degrees per second will be greater. At point B, our nose, the imaginary pencil extended out through our propeller spinner, is touching the distant 45 degree point. This will also be the point of maximum right rudder input as we are adding rudder for the right turn as well as the pitch up for the climb. Now, from points B to C, We will also be pitching and rolling, but now pitching down gradually back to level while continuing to roll to increase the bank to maximum. As we progress through the pitch change from B to C, don't think of it as pushing the nose down so much as releasing back pressure to let the pitch come down. However, keep the roll going. At point C, we have let the nose pitch down to level, and we are now at our maximum bank angle of 30 degrees. From C to D, we are continuing with the pitch going down, again, more of a release of back pressure than a dive, and starting our roll to the left back to wings level. Our airspeed is back on the rise, and so our control effectiveness is increasing. At point D, our imaginary pencil extended from our propeller spinner is touching the distant 135 degree point, and we are at maximum pitch down. Now, important, the pitch change from level will be less at point D with the nose down than it is at point B with the nose up, but the maneuver is still symmetrical since the pitch up in each climb should be the same and the pitch down in each dive should be the same. From D to E, we are arresting the pitch down and easing the nose gradually up to level while we continue the roll to the left back to wings level. At point E, the airplane should be back at straight and level with the same entry altitude and airspeed as when we began at point A. Only now, our distant 90 degree reference point is on our left wing tip. Now we have completed one loop, which is one quarter of the total maneuver. As we climb away to the left, away from point E, we will have more of a balanced rudder input since left rudder will be needed for the roll to the left, but right rudder will be needed for the pitch up. Notice as we start this loop, the reference points have reversed, but they are the same 3 points. As we climb to the left, away from point E, what was the 135 degree point is now the 45 degree point. Remember, for each loop, these points will flip. As we continue the second loop in figure 10-4, applying the required stick and rudder skills to stay smooth and coordinated, we will come back to straight and level with the same entry airspeed and altitude as when we began at point A. And now our distant 90 degree reference point will again be on our right wingtip. We have now completed one half of the lazy eight maneuver. Now, because we started the first half of the maneuver at point A with a right turn, we'll begin the second half of the maneuver with a left turn and complete two more loops. At the completion of the next two loops, you will have flown 4 total loops and completed a lazy figure eight laying on its side. Now, pay close attention to your stick and rudder skills. Chair fly the maneuver, moving a model in your hand, and call out to yourself what is happening with altitude and airspeed, pitch and bank, aileron and rudder inputs as you progress through all four loops. Rewind this video and refer back to the Airplane Flying Handbook Chapter 10 as needed. And you'll soon see the Lazy 8 is one of the most fun and rewarding maneuvers to fly. Well, folks, that completes the Lazy 8, and that completes this video. We'll see you next time.